Okay, let's now consider exercise 2 in problem set 10. So, first I'll just briefly go through the framework here and state the first question. Then I'll just give you a brief sort of overview of the information that we're given, and then I'll continue to the hints that you can use to try and solve this question on your own, okay? And then afterwards I'll present the solution. Okay, so just to be clear on the plan here. So the framework is the following. Consider the following model of monetary policy with repetition. The government controls inflation directly, i.e. pi t is equal to mt, where m is the rate of growth of money supply. And its instantaneous loss function is given by the following expression here, where xt, here and here, is equal to theta t plus pi t minus pi t e, and pi t denotes inflation. Pi to e denotes expected inflation, and xt is the level of employment. Potential level of employment, theta t here, is random and id, so that's a random variable. The parameter lambda, which is strictly greater than zero, measures the relative importance of output fluctuations relative to input relative to inflation fluctuations. So, if we can see here that the instantaneous loss function is quadratic in a pi t and xt here, and if lambda is relatively high, then fluctuations in output or employment matter relatively more. Okay, so the intertemporal loss function is given by the following expression here, which is basically just a discounted sum of instantaneous loss functions, where beta between 0 and 1 is a time discount factor or time preference rate. The government's reputation affects expected inflation and depends on past behavior. So pi to e here, expected inflation is equal to what we denote pi c if pi t minus 1 was also equal to pi c, and pi to e is equal to pi d otherwise, where pi c denotes the optimal policy under commitment and pi d under discretion respectively. So the first thing we're now asked to do is to compute the equilibrium policy under commitment and under discretion respectively. So just like a short comment here, I think it's very important to be aware of the timing in the model. So in this very simple framework, we can sort of basically write up the timing of the model and not distinguishing too much between sort of discretion and commitment. So the first step here basically applies to commitment. So if the authorities follow a commitment rule, then the way that inflation depends on potential employment is determined here. Okay, so this monetary policy rule is determined in this first step. So that's determined before observing a actual potential employment, and this is announced to the public at this stage. Then second step, potential employment, theta t, is determined or announced. Then in third step, private agents form the expectations about inflation, pi to e here, based on past inflation and potential employment. And then fourth and finally, the government chooses realized inflation pi t or mt by choosing money supply. Okay, and this very simple case, mt is simply just equal to pi t, right? That's what we had before. Okay, and then I also think you should note that we can write the inflation expectation for the following way. So basically just taking what was given in the text and just formalize it a bit mathematically. So pi to e here is equal to the commitment inflation level if pi t minus 1 was also equal to the commitment inflation level. And otherwise pi to e will be equal to the discretionary inflation level. Okay. Then before I give the answer to the question, I'll just give you hints for that you can use to try and solve this exercise without before watching me giving the solutions here. So in the question, we're asked to compute the equilibrium policy under commitment and under discretion, respectively. So first, in order to solve for the commitment case, then we know from the Pearson and Tavolini book that's part of the syllabus for this course, from page 399 to be precise, that as the loss function is quadratic in inflation and employment, the optimal policy rule must be linear in potential employment. So that is pi t here should be a function of psi and psi theta t here, implying that the expectation of inflation conditional on information about theta t should also be equal to this expression here. Now, being aware of this, you can use this to find a xt, so that's employment or output, and the loss, so that's the x post loss function. Having found xt and l, you can find the x and the loss function by simply just taking expectations to this expression. That follows quite directly. And then we can use the first order conditions with respect to psi and psi theta to find optimal policy parameters. And now finally, having found these parameters here, you should now be able to tell what is inflation under commitment. So that's knowing these parameters, what will inflation be in each period, and what will the employment gap, output gap employment, XC here be under commitment. So that's when you have found pi, you will also know the expectations about pi, and you can plug that into the expression for X here. So finally, you should then use your results here and interpret and say and ask yourself what is the intuition behind the commitment inflation and the commitment employment level in this economy. And now, solving for discretion, you follow quite similar approach, but it's not the exact same thing. Because when the authorities follow this discretionary monetary policy, we cannot make an assumption that private agents get the expectations right in each period, which would be that pi t would be equal to the expectation of pi t conditional theta t, which is the following here. So what you should do now is just that you should simply just write up the loss function without assuming this as such. And then having written up the loss function, you should take first order condition to find the optimal inflation level. So before we were to find the optimal parameters, but now that the authorities don't follow a commitment rule anymore, we should just find the optimal level of inflation instead. So having found this, you can now take expectations to the inflation rate to get the expectations of pi t conditional theta t, and thereby effectively implementing rational expectations. And then you can plug this expected inflation level back into the expression for pi t, and then you should be able to see what the inflation is in the discretionary case and what the employment gap or employment XD is under this discretionary policy. And again, ask yourself, what does this mean and what would the intuition behind this result be? Okay, so with these hints in hand, I'll now proceed to the solution. Okay, so if you want to try and solve this on your own, then it's now that you stop the video. Okay, so first we try and solve a commitment. So just to be clear, our objective here is to use our expression for the loss function in order to arrive at an optimal policy parameters. However, we must first use the information that has been given to us in order to turn the loss function into something manageable that we can take first order conditions to. Okay, so this here really outlines our approach. So the first thing that we should notice, as I said previously, we know from Pearson and Tavolini, page 399, that when we have a loss function that's quadratic, the optimal policy rule must be linear in potential employment. So that is, we have the following rule here. And by the way, I would say that I really suggest that you try and read this chapter. I think it's chapter 15 in the Pearson Tabellini book. I think it's quite good, actually. But here they basically tell that a policy rule must have the following form when the loss function is quadratic. And now we know that the inflation expectations among private agents becomes the following here. So what we notice is that the timing was the following. So we know that the authorities have chosen some monetary policy rule to begin with, and then potential employment is determined, and then private agents form the expectations knowing about this policy rule and knowing about potential employment. So therefore, expected inflation is equal to these like rational expectations where they use all information about theta t, which is simply just equal to this policy rule here. Okay, and plugging these two expressions into the expression for xt, we see that employment simply just becomes equal to theta t, because pi t will always be the same as pi t e, implying that they cancel out, and we're just left with xt being equal to theta t, employment being equal to this potential employment variable. Okay, so having an expression for pi t, so that's the policy rule, and having an expression for xt, that when we got that from implementing the policy rule into the expression for xt and using that private agents have rational expectations, we can get the following loss function here. So instead of pi t here, we substitute in the policy rule here, and instead of xt here, we substitute in potential employment that we had from before here. And what we should be aware of is that when determining the policy parameters, that's what happens in stage one in the model. So that's the first thing that happens in the model. Then the government, the government or the authorities, they don't know what the realized level of potential employment will actually be. So therefore, in order to take first order conditions, we first need to use the expectations operator on this loss function. Because what they will use to take first order conditions is expected loss and not loss, because they don't know the realized loss. Okay. So we have this loss function, and then we take expectations to this expression. And what I've done here is that I've just taken expectations to this expression here, and then I've just written out what's inside the parentheses to get the following expression here. Okay. So now we choose the policy parameters such that the expected loss is minimized. And that's done simply by taking first order conditions with respect to psi and psi theta here. And notice that we're not taking first order conditions with respect to lambda here, because lambda is not a policy parameter. That's at least not something that the authorities can choose. That's in this case more like a structural parameter in our model. Okay, in this case, in this model. Okay, so we take first order conditions with respect to psi and psi theta. We take the first derivative of expected loss with respect to psi, getting the following expression here, and then we set it equal to zero here. Okay, and isolating psi, we get the following expression. Similarly, we can take the first derivative of expected loss with respect to psi theta here and get the following expression here and set it equal to zero. So that's our first order condition for psi theta. Now we can take this expression for this optimality condition here for psi and plug it into the expression here and get the following
expression. Here, verify that you can actually do this. And then we see that here, this is actually an expression for the variance of theta. So for any positive variance on theta, so if theta is indeed stochastic, then it's optimal, then it can only be optimal to set psi theta here equal to zero. In turn, this implies that psi must also be zero. So setting psi theta here, up here, equal to zero, we get that psi must also be zero. And for this reason, inflation under the commitment regime or with commitment policy simply becomes equal to zero, which is our inflation target in this model. So with the commitment rule, we get that inflation becomes equal to the inflation target, which is zero in this model. And then using this result up here, we get that the output gap simply becomes theta t. You can see that directly now here, but we also had that from before. So the interpretation is basically that this monetary policy rule becomes an anchor for inflation expectations. And this rule is not conditional on potential employment. Because if it were, this would be expected by the private agents and only add costly noise to inflation. And hence, in this case, inflation is full stabilized and shocks to potential employment are passed right onto employment. Okay. So I guess you can see, because the private agents also observe data, then if the authorities try to choose to let inflation in the economy depend on theta, it would be perfectly expected by the private agents, because they have the same information about the government and they know about their policy rule, and therefore the gap between pi t and expected pi t would simply just be equal to zero, but then pi would suddenly fluctuate with potential employment. While setting psi and psi theta equal to zero, we get that pi becomes independent of these shocks to potential employment. And that's why I say that if the rule did indeed depend on potential employment, then we would simply just add costly noise to inflation. Okay. And then just before I go to the next slide, notice that I have a typo here. This here, this is just a definition of XT implementing rational expectations on pi t e. This should be a minus instead of a plus. So that's just a typo. Okay. Now we solve for the discretionary case. So now that the authorities follow, in this case, a discretionary strategy, they don't have to stick to policy parameters determined before shock realizations. So they don't anymore have to commit to these psi and psi theta parameters. They just choose pi t in the fourth step of the timing that I showed before. So they simply just choose money supply or money growth, mt, which is equal to pi t, in order to minimize realized loss. But in turn, this affects the expectations of private agents. Okay, so let's see how this works. So what we do now is that we simply just write up the loss function by plugging in the definition of xt here. So the loss function becomes the following, knowing that xt is simply just equal to theta t plus pi t minus pi t here. We do not plug any monetary policy rule into the expression as we did before. And now, for now, we simply just take private agents' expectations about inflation as given. So now the authorities simply just choose the inflation rate, or MT, that minimizes this loss function. So here I've simply just taken the first order condition of a loss with respect to a pi t here. So I take the first derivative of LT with respect to pi t and set it equal to zero and get the following expression here. And the reason why I don't use the expectations operator on the loss function anymore, that's what I did before, was that when the if the authorities followed a commitment rule, they had to choose the policy parameters psi and psi theta before shocks to potential output were realized. But now in this discretionary case, as we saw in the on the timing slide, a pi t is simply just chosen as the very last thing. So pi t is now chosen after potential employment is realized. So that's why we take the first derivative of loss and not expected loss with respect to pi t. Okay. So rearranging this first derivative here, or the first order condition here, and isolating pi t, we get the following expression here. Okay, so we may now ask, what are these inflation expectations here? Okay, so in order to see this, we simply just take expectations to the expression. And notice that private agents and authorities have the same information about the economy. Both the private agents and the authorities know about this theta t. So here we basically just implement rational expectations. We say that private agents, their inflation expectations simply just equal to this using this expectations operator and conditioning on theta t. So taking the expectations condition on theta t, we get the following expression here. So that's using the expectations operator here and plugging it in here instead of this pi t e. Okay. And rearranging this expression, we get that pi t e is equal to these like rational expectations of pi t condition on theta t, which is equal to minus lambda theta t. Okay, so knowing that the authorities follow a discretionary policy, private agents expect the authorities to reduce inflation when there are positive shocks to potential employment, and thereby reduce the employment gap or the output gap, XT here. So the private agents, they know that the government or the authorities will try to reduce inflation when theta t is high. So that's incorporated in their expectations, basically. And now we can find realized expectations by simply just taking the expression for pi t here and plugging in pi t e here and get the following expression here. Okay, so we clearly see that in the discretionary case, in realized inflation simply just becomes equal to expected inflation. And the realized employment gap therefore still just becomes XT being equal to theta t. That's also what we had under the commitment rule. So clearly in this case, inflation is no longer fully stabilized because now inflation is no longer just zero, but shocks to potential employment are still passed right onto employment. So how can this be? So this is what we'll generally call the inflation bias, and it comes from the fact that credibility problems make it impossible for the government to stabilize employment under this discretionary policy. So the government is basically not capable of stabilizing employment at a shock to potential employment by creating supplies inflation, as this strategy will be foreseen by private agents, because in this very simple model, private agents have the same information about the economy as the government has. So if the government tries to use inflation strategically in some sense and responding to shocks to potential employment, private agents will simply know about this and incorporate this in their expectations, and therefore this attempt at making surprise inflation will not affect XT at all. Instead, the government or the authorities have simply just created a costly costly volatility to inflation, because now inflation will shift with shocks to potential employment. Okay, now let's consider question two. Question B says, compute the optimal deviation for a government that is expected to play pi C, so that's the commitment policy. What are the benefits and the costs of such a deviation? For what value of theta is it optimal for the government to stick to the commitment rule? Okay, so before I give the answer to this question, I have produced a few hints or an approach that you can take a look at and pause the video and try and use to pause the video and try and solve the question on your own before watching me give answers to the questions. But okay, so the hints are as follows. So the first thing that you should do is that you should find the benefits associated with deviating from commitment in some period T here. So we start out by using that pi T E here is equal to zero because we were in a commitment regime in the previous period. So using this, you should write up the loss function and find the optimal inflation rate conditional on the expectations being equal to this. Now, with this optimal inflation rate in hand, you should then compute the benefits, and this is what I call B theta T, of making a deviation from commitment by comparing the realized loss under commitment to the realized loss from deviating. Okay. However, you should also take into account that if the authorities choose to deviate from the commitment policy, they also affect the expectations of the private agents in the model. So therefore, the future loss functions will be changed by this action. So when the authorities determine whether they should deviate from the commitment policy, they should also take into account that the expected loss in future periods changes. And this will in the end be what they use to sort of determine whether they will deviate or not. They will take the benefits in the current period into account, but they will also take the expected losses from deviating in the future into account. So in order to find these losses or benefits, as I call them, just to sort of stay in the same terminology here, from deviating from commitment, you should first realize that either in period T plus one, the authorities can go back to commitment, realize a loss from choosing the commitment policy again, and then everything is back to normal. So what they do here in period T plus one is that they choose a commitment policy while the private agents expect a discretionary policy. So then the authorities realize loss and they were sort of back to the commitment case. Or the other thing that the authorities can do is that they can follow discretionary monetary policy in the future. Okay, so they can also choose to stay on the discretionary track. So what you should do now is that you should compute the expected benefit or loss associated with each of these two sort of paths that the authorities can choose. And then you should find out which has the lowest loss on expectation. Okay, so take the expectation to these two losses. And then given the preferred future strategy, then you should find out when a shock to the economy in period T is big enough to make it optimal to deviate from commitment. So what you have done here is that you have basically computed the expected benefit or the expected loss from deviating from the commitment policy. And then here you simply evaluate what values of theta make it optimal to deviate from the commitment policy, or the other way around, what values of theta make it optimal not to deviate from the commitment strategy. Okay. So if you want to make an attempt at answering the question with these hints in hand, you should now pause the video because I'll proceed to the answers now. Okay. So firstly, you should remember from before that the inflation expectations are given by this rule here. So expected inflation is equal to the commitment inflation rate if the inflation rate in the previous period was equal to the commitment inflation rate, and else it will be equal to this discretionary inflation rate. Okay. So, and this is what we'll assume in this case, that if the authorities paid the commitment inflation rate in period T minus one, then we have that in period T, the expected inflation is equal to zero. So this is sort of predetermined. We can't do anything about this. That's our setting in period T. In the previous period, the authorities paid commitment. Okay, so that's why pi TE here is equal to zero. So now, if the authorities choose to deviate from the commitment policy and discretionarily chooses the money supply or the inflation rate, the authorities basically solve the following minimization problem here. So they minimize the loss function, where I have simply just plugged in theta t plus pi t minus pi t e instead of x t here. And going from here to here, I have simply just plugged in that pi t e is equal to zero. So expected inflation will be equal to zero. Now, taking first order conditions to this problem here, so taking the first derivative of loss with respect to pi t here and set equal to zero gives the following expression here. And now I can simply just isolate pi t here and call the optimal inflation rate pi t star here, which is given by the following expression here. So the optimal inflation rate is some negative function of a realized potential employment, where if output stabilization is relatively important, then the response in the inflation rate becomes stronger. Okay, and now we can plug this pi t star into the xt from up here, where we have set pi t e equal to zero, and we get the following expression down here. Okay. So now with the optional pi t star here and the xt that follows, we can compute the benefits of deviating from commitment in period T. So we define benefits simply as minus the difference in loss functions between deviating from commitment here and the loss associated from simply just staying in a commitment regime. So if we stay in a commitment regime, then pi t will simply just be equal to the inflation target, which is zero, and then the employment will simply just be equal to potential employment theta t. And if we deviate, we get that pi t here is equal to the expression that we derived before, and then we get that xt is equal to 1 over 1 plus lambda theta t. And then the benefits are simply just minus the difference in losses. Okay. So what we do now is that we simply just plug in the loss functions evaluated in these expressions here, and we get the following result here. So because this is the inflation rate, and the inflation rate is in the loss function, it enters squared, right? So we square what's the inflation rate here, and we square a xt here and multiply with lambda this structural taste parameter here. And the loss associated with a commitment is simply just given by the expression here, because inflation is zero and xt will simply just be equal to theta t, and we square xt, so it implies that we square theta t. So that's the benefits in period t from deviating from the commitment strategy. So we want to reduce this expression. In order to do that, we basically just take whatever we can outside the parentheses. So here I take 1 over 1 plus lambda squared outside of the parentheses. So I take this thing here outside the parentheses and this thing here. And then I take theta t to the power of 2 also outside the parentheses here. Okay. You should be able to verify that you can go from this step to this step here. And then I just basically reduce what's inside this parenthesis here and get that the benefits are given by the expression here. Okay. So this expression is clearly positive. So if the inflation expectations by the private agents are stuck at this commitment inflation rate, then the authorities can actually get a benefit from creating this kind of surprise inflation and thereby stabilizing output, okay, or stabilizing employment. Okay. So now in period T plus one, the authorities have two options. So what they can do is that they can first choose to go back to the commitment policy. So choosing pi T plus one equal to zero being equal to the inflation target. Then from period T plus two and onwards, the private agents will expect commitment policy again, and then we'll be back in the sort of normal commitment case where inflation is equal to the commitment inflation, and the private agents expect that inflation will be equal to this commitment rate of inflation. But in period T plus one, there will be a loss that we'll compute in a minute, from the fact that now, because in period T, the authorities chose to deviate from commitment, the private agents will expect that pi t plus one will be equal to the deviation inflation rate, while in fact the government chooses the commitment inflation rate. Okay. The other thing you can do is that it can simply just continue to play this discretion inflation rate from period T plus one and onwards. And when the authorities stand in period T and just try and decide whether they should deviate from the commitment policy in period T, then they don't know what potential employment will be in period T plus one and on and onwards, and therefore if it will be optimal to choose to remain in the discretionary regime in period T plus one, then it will also on expectation be optimal to remain on this discretionary path. Okay. So in order to proceed, we need three things. We need the loss function associated with going back to the commitment policy after having deviated from the commitment policy. So that's the loss function associated with this strategy in period T plus one. Then we need the loss function associated with staying at the discretionary path. So that's the loss function associated with this thing here. And then finally, we need the loss function associated with commitment in period T plus one, given commitment in period T. And we simply need this in order to compare these strategies to a strategy where we just stay on the commitment path in all periods. Okay, so this is only for comparison. This is only to evaluate the benefits of the two other strategies. And we already have the ingredients for the last two here from question one here. So that is, we already know the inflation rate and the employment level as a function of realized potential employment when staying on a discretionary path. We already solved for that in question one. And we also know the inflation rate and the employment rate or the employment level when staying on a commitment path. The only thing that we will have to solve for as such is that we'll have to find the employment level and the inflation level when going from a discretionary state to a commitment policy. Okay. So in order to find the loss associated with going back to commitment, we first use that when we choose to go back to commitment, the realized inflation level will be equal to the commitment level, which is just zero. That's what we solved for in question one. And we use that employment simply just follows immediately as xt plus one equal to theta t plus one plus this pi c here, which will be equal to zero, minus the expected inflation. And we know expected inflation in from question one to be equal to minus lambda theta t plus one. So plug that in here and set pi c equal to zero and get the following expression here. Okay. So by going back to commitment, the expected, and now I'm calling it benefits, but it's because it's in fact a loss in period T plus one are given by the following expression here. And I know that B bar here of theta T plus one here. So again, it's minus the difference in expected losses by being on this path where we chose a discretionary policy in period T, and now we're going back to commitment in period T plus one, and then comparing that loss to the loss that would have occurred if we simply just had stayed on the commitment path all the time. And now here I've multiplied it with the time preference rate. So plugging in these two loss functions here, get the following here. So in both cases, the inflation level, it will be equal to zero, so that doesn't enter the benefit expression, but in a but there will be the response to employment as a function of potential employment will be stronger in the case of going back to the commitment policy compared to the case where we had been on the commitment path all the time. Okay, so here we square this expression here and multiply by lambda here. And here we square simply just theta t plus one and multiply by lambda.
And remember that when deciding whether we will deviate or not in period T, we don't know what the realized levels of potential employment will be in period T plus one. So therefore, we use the expectations operator here. So this is the expected benefits, or the expected loss, or what you would call it, from being on this deviation path and going back to commitment. So reducing this expression a bit, we get the following here. Okay. So we should be able to verify that we can in fact go from here to here. Okay. So this expression here is clearly negative, and that's because it's costly to return to the commitment policy, and that's because the inflation expectations, or the expectations would be that we'll respond to a shock to potential outcome where it in fact will not be the case, and that creates a cost for the authorities. So that's why this expression is clearly unambiguously negative. Okay, and in future periods, so in period T plus two and onwards, the loss or the benefit will simply just be equal to zero, because then we are back in a case where the expectations are that we'll be on a commitment path, and we are also on a commitment path. So from period T plus one, period T plus two and onwards, the loss or the benefits of having chosen this path will deviate and then going back to commitment will simply just be zero. Now, by remaining in a discretionary regime, the expected benefits in period T plus one are given by the following expression here, where I have now plugged in this loss function with the discretionary inflation rate and the resulting employment here. So I compare these two loss functions at this minus, because I'm considering benefits, so minus the losses, and then I'm multiplying this time preference rate here. So plugging in the loss functions, we go from here to here. So again, we square the inflation rate on expectation, and we square the we take the expectation to the squared employment level, which is just theta t plus one, and then we multiply by lambda, and then we do the same thing with this loss function here, the loss function associated with just being the commitment path all along. So reducing this expression here, we get the following expression here. Okay. So this is also clearly negative. And this is basically just something we already knew. It's costly to be in a discretionary regime over time, because we are not able to stabilize output at all, but we are inducing more volatility in inflation than we would have done if we just had stayed in a commitment regime. So, but in contrast to the case where we deviated from the commitment policy in period T and then went back to the commitment policy in T plus one, then this cost where we just stay on the discretionary path, we will keep incurring this cost. So we will have to live with this cost in all periods from period T plus one and onwards. So therefore, the benefits be underlined here of choosing this discretionary path after having been on the commitment path becomes this sum of discounted benefits in all future periods, where beta is this discount factor, right? So we just take this expression here and then we just sum it, where we multiply each element in the sum with beta to the power of I, where I is the periods this number of periods after period T. And then we use that this potential employment volatility here, the expectation of theta squared, is the same in all periods because IID. Then we can take that out of the summation operator. We can do the same thing, 1 over 2 lambda squared. So then we're basically just summing these betas here. And then we realize that this here is in fact an infinite geometric series, implying that this sum of beta to the power of I can be written as beta over 1 minus beta. And the reason why it becomes beta over 1 minus beta and not just 1 over 1 minus beta, as we usually see when we have an infinite geometric series, is because this series starts at I being equal to 1, where what we've often seen in this course is that these series start at I being equal to 0. So now we have to determine which of these two strategies in period T plus 1 are preferred. So that is, what we're doing now is basically that we're standing in period T, and then we're saying, okay, if we choose to deviate in period T, what will be the optimal strategy from period T plus 1 and onwards on expectation? So what we do is we just compare these two benefits that we derive. We compare the benefits on staying on the discretionary path to the benefits of it going back to the commitment regime here. And we basically want to choose the benefits that are highest, okay, where both of them are negative. So we want to choose the one that is least negative. So here I just took the benefits from before and plugged them in. These are the benefit levels that we derived just before. And then here we can see that the benefits associated with the discretionary path will be highest when beta is lower than this expression here. And if you can't see this immediately, then I suggest that you try and do the same derivation. That you compare these two benefit levels, plug in the derivation that we had from before, and then just isolate beta. Then you can see that the benefits associated with being on the discretionary path will be highest when beta is lower than this expression, yeah, which is clearly smaller than 1. Hence, when beta is relatively low, the benefits associated with remaining in discretion are highest, and vice versa. So what is the intuition for this? So the discretionary regime will incur a cost in all future periods, but this cost will be relatively low. And we're basically comparing a relatively low cost that will incur in every periods until like in all future periods to a relatively high cost that we're only incurring once. So when the future is not valued too much, it's better to choose the discretionary path where we experience an infinite series of costs. But this again is only optimal when we don't put too much weight on the future. So that's when beta is relatively low. If beta is high and we care a lot about the future, it's better just to incur this high cost associated with going back to commitment once and just being on the commitment track from there on. Okay. And now I just included a very quick illustration to sort of show how you can think of the costs associated following these two different strategies. So here, on the first axis here, we have time. And on the second axis, we have the cost relative to just following the commitment strategy from period T and onwards, so not deviating at all. And the red circles here is an example of what the costs could look like when deviating from the
commitment strategy in period T, and then going back to the commitment strategy in period T plus one and onwards, while the green circles are the are an example of what the cost could look like when one deviates from the commitment strategy and then keeps following a discretionary path. So you can basically see here that there is a sort of cost in one period from going back to the commitment strategy in period T plus one, while there keeps being a cost over time when one chooses to follow a discretionary strategy. So depending on how these future relative costs relative to just being on the commitment strategy all the time, depending on how these are weighted, so that's the betas, how we weight these future costs, that determines whether it's conditional on deviating, whether it's a conditional on deviating in period T, then these weights determine whether it's optimal to go back to commitment in T plus one or not. Okay, so again, just a very quick illustration of an example here. Okay, so now first assume that going back to commitment in period T plus one is preferred conditional on deviating in period T. Then deviating from commitment in the first place will only be preferred if the benefits of deviating in period T plus the benefits of deviating in period T plus one are positive, and where we know that this is in fact a cost because the benefits are negative. Now, plugging in the benefit expressions from before, we get the following expression here. So this is what needs to be positive before it's optimal to deviate in the first place. Rearranging this expression, and I suggest that you try and do that, we get the following condition here for deviating. So hence, it will only be optimal to deviate if the shock to potential employment is very big. So that is that this thing here is large in absolute numbers. The future costs are not valued much, so that is when if beta here is low. If potential employment is not very volatile in general, so that's if this thing here is low. Or if shocks to employment are not punished harshly in the loss function, so that's if these lambdas here are low. Okay. Now, instead, assume that remaining in the discretionary regime is optimal, conditional on deviating in period T. Then deviating from commitment in the first place is only preferred if the benefits associated with deviating period T plus the benefits in all future periods are positive, where we know that this expression again is negative. Now, plugging in the benefit expressions from before, so that's this benefit expression and this benefit expression, we get the following condition here. Okay, and again, you should be able to verify that you can go from here to here, and then again, rearrange and show that you can go from here to this condition here on theta t. So you should be able to verify that you can go from here to here to here. Okay, so qualitatively, the intuition here is exactly the same. So again, the most important thing to notice is that that it can be optimal to deviate in period T from the commitment strategy when there is a large shock to the economy, to potential employment in the economy.